brought to you by Geritol, the high-potency vitamin iron-rich tonic in liquid or tablets to help you feel stronger. And now, let's all play What's My Line? And now, live from New York, let's meet our What's My Line panel. First, the popular columnist whose voice of Broadway appears in papers from coast to coast, Miss Dorothy Kilgallen.
And now, a beautiful actor and a wonderful panelist, Mr. Martin Gabel.
On my left, the first and last Mrs. Gabel, Miss Arlene Francis.
I'm glad to hear that. And now, the distinguished president of Random House, whom we all love dearly, Mr. Bennett Cerf.
And here's our linguistic wizard, a man who takes longer to say one sentence than it took Gordon Cooper to go around the world 22 times, John Charles Daly.
All that may be very true, but I can say wizard quicker than he can. Now, this, in a way, is a kind of significant week for alumni, I guess. I've been up at Tilton School, my prep school, for an alumni gathering. But I've done some good reporting, too, for the week. And at the risk of embarrassing an old friend of mine, I would announce that this is the year is the 50th anniversary of the Columbia School of Journalism. And on Wednesday of this week, an alumnus of the Graduate School of Journalism, to wit, one Bennett Cerf, was given a Distinguished Alumni Award for Achievement. So there. Well, there are many things about Bennett we very rarely get to say, but he's an old-time newspaper man. Your first job was with the New York Herald Tribune, wasn't it?
Yes, didn't last long. I was fired.
He was fired.
That'll show him.
And that's how he got to be a successful publisher. So I'll see if I can get fired somewhere this week myself. Martin, it's very nice to see you on the panel again, sir.
John, it's always a pleasure to see you.
And I think we'll have some fun tonight. We have some very interesting occupations. More than that, as usual, we'll have our famous mystery guest before my friends on the panel a little bit later in the program, and we'll meet our first challenger. Meet our first contestant. Will you enter and sign in, please? Joe W. Schmitt, right, sir? Schmitt, where are you from?
I'm from O'Fallon, Illinois, and I've just recently moved to Texas.
Texas? Well, you're doing some traveling. It's nice to have you with us. I'm glad you came to New York, too. Mr. Schmitt, may I present the panel? Now, would you join me over here, please?
You know how we keep score?
Yes.
All right, then we'll let the audience in the theater and the audience at home know exactly what your line is. All right, panel, we can tell you that Mr. Schmitt is salaried and that he deals in a service. And let's begin the general questioning with Dorothy Kilgallen.
Mr. Schmitt, is your work mental rather than physical?
No.
That's one down and nine to go. Mr. Gabel.
Is your work done outdoors, Mr. Schmitt, more than it is indoors?
No.
That's two down and eight to go, Miss Fred.
Clean score so far.
Do you work with your hands in your job, Mr. Schmitt?
Yes.
Do you work with anything other than human beings in your job?
You speak of other living entities than human beings?
Yes. I know it's a no, John, but yes.
No.
3 down and 7 to go, better.
Mr. Schmitt, do you work for a non-profit making organization?
Yes.
Is it some kind of a government job?
Yes.
Is it a federal government job?
Yes, it is.
Did you have anything whatever to do with the flight of Gordon Cooper concluded the other day?
Yes, sir.
You did. You say you work indoors.
Sir.
Did you have anything to do with the mechanism that tracked his course as he went flying through the heavens?
No.
That's 4 down and 6 to go, but congratulations, Bennett. You've opened a big door, and I'll be quite honest with you. This is going to be difficult for you to get, but it's an extremely interesting assignment. You try, Dorothy.
Mr. Schmitt, you said that your work was physical more than mental.
Yes.
Were you in Florida at the time of the blast-off?
Yes, I was.
Were you at Cape Canaveral?
Yes.
Were you within 100 yards of the gantry?
Yes.
Were you, in fact, at the missile launching site?
Yes.
Right next to it. Did you have anything to do with lifting Gordon Cooper or putting him into the capsule?
Yes.
Did you put him into the capsule?
He had an assignment, Dorothy, that had a relationship to the whole concatenation of events, which saw Cooper go into the capsule and then subsequently remain there.
He was the master of ceremonies.
No, but very good. Martin?
Mr. Schmitt, as my wife will tell you, I can't do anything with my hands. So I don't think I can be very helpful here, and I pass.
All right, Arlene?
Well, now, the fact is that you were present when he entered the capsule. Is that, we are on that?
Yes.
We're that far. Did you hold something in your hands at this particular time?
No.
Not exactly. I'm going to put all the cards over because this is really great. Mr. Schmitt is a space suit technician and was actually the last man in the capsule with Major Cooper. He makes the connections from between the space suit and the capsule. He helped to dress him, or did dress him, goes out with him, checks him in the capsule.
Why
did
it get so hot? That space suit.
They closed that door too soon. You'd have been in there with them, wouldn't you?
I was watching that.
John?
Yes, Dorothy?
I think Mr. Schmidt's title should be Space Valet.
Space Valet.
Or Scientific Valet.
Very good. It would be a good one. I dare say they've thought of that down at Cape Canaveral because they have a patois all of their own down there, and that probably comes into it, too. But I think Arlene's question was very interesting. Can you tell us, you know, why the variations in temperature? Is this
Well, this has happened on most all of our flights so far. Actually, this is not in my area. This pertains to the environmental control system and the adjustment that they make to properly cool the suit is a slow is one. It's one that requires a little time after you make a slight adjustment.
It because
takes
it
a while
cool.
for it to stabilize.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
He said that he was cool after a while.
Yeah, this is so.
Yes.
Once you get it adjusted, you don't have any further problems.
May I ask you a personal question? Are you any youngsters yourself?
Yes, they're not really so young. I have one daughter who is married. And I have a son going to high school.
Oh, great. I was just thinking, what a wonderful position to be in as a father. And say, well, Daddy, what do you do? Well, I dress all the astronauts every hour before they go upstairs. Boy, I fix their suits. I'm a spacesuit man. What a wonderful occupation as a father these days to be a spacesuit man. Well, needless to say, it hardly, I guess, has to be said. We hope if you see Major Cooper that you will give him our very best and our congratulations and all those who are in that great company, John Glenn and Walter Sherrod, and certainly Shorty Powers ought to get a good hello, too. He's one of the best men on that microphone we ever heard. Give them all our regards and thanks for coming to see us, Mr.
Thank you.
Nice to see you. And now to meet our second contestant. Will you enter and sign in, please? Rhea? Well, as an old history student, Tawny, right? Is it Miss or Mrs.?
Yes.
Miss Tawny, and where are you from?
Manhattan. Manhattan. Oh, well, you're right at home this evening. Then, Miss Tawney, may I present our panel? Now, will you join me over here, please?
Do you know how we keep score?
Yes.
All right, then we'll let the audience at home and the audience in the theater know exactly what your line is. All right, panel, we can tell you that Miss Tawney is salaried and deals in a service, and we'll begin the general questioning with that distinguished alumni over there, Mr. Cerf, alumnus, rather, Mr. Cerf. So I got it out for you, did.
Don't be a wizard. Miss Tawney, do you perform your service for members of the human race?
Yes.
For men and women?
Yes.
Do they come to you for this service?
Yes.
Do they, when they come to you for the service, do you come into any kind of physical contact with them?
No.
That's one down and nine to go. This does not rule out that there would be accidental or completely casual contact, but it's not critical, Ben. One down and nine to go, Miss Kilgallen.
Miss Tawney, you look quite athletic, are you?
No.
That's two down. So, since it was a question I think sought to derive some valuable information. We got a flat note, Dorothy. I have to give it 2 down of 8 to go. Martin?
Do you improve the people who come to deal with you?
Do I improve them?
Yes.
No.
No, I don't think so. 3 down of 7 to go, Miss Francis?
They come to you indoors. Do you instruct or... you did say you work indoors, or didn't you?
No,
that was not asked. I'm sorry.
It hasn't been asked, though.
No. Well, do you?
No.
That's
no.
Fine.
Well,
4 down and 6 to go, Mr. Cerf.
Miss Tawney, when you're performing your service, do you wear some kind of dress other than the ordinary street costume or young lady? Is it a costume that is would be recognized easily at sight?
You mean as identifying the...
As identifying more or less what she was up to?
Yes.
It would tend to, Bennett. I don't want to mislead you. I would say that given the circumstance, the scene, and the costume, you would very probably adduce. But this is not to suggest that any stranger might say, oh, that's that, you know?
In other words, if John, for once in his life, is being honest, this is not a uniform that could be recognized at sight.
No.
Mm-hmm. Yes, it is not. That's right.
It is not.
Yes, it is not.
Do you wear this costume for some kind of protective purpose?
No.
No, don't think so. No.
Just to cover her up?
It just is. It's good. It's working garb, Bennett. That's the thing that we want to make
and
it clear.
Wearing slacks or something like
that. No.
No, it's working garb. 5 down and 5 to go, Miss Kilgallen.
Well, then, is the intent of having this costume to be more theatrical, more attractive, attract attention?
No,
it's just working garb, that's all. But it is not of such character that seeing it, you would immediately identify the occupation.
Right.
Mr. Gabel.
Am I right in remembering that we have not established what sort of place you work in?
You're right.
Is it in any way related to an entertainment, this outdoor thing?
No.
7 down and 3 to go, Miss Francis.
You have an addiction to the word no.
That's good
Tawney.
For girls.
You know,
I was a girl once. Is this occupation of yours, does it take place? Are you at work on or near water?
No.
8 down and 2 to go, Mr. Smith.
Miss Tawney, do you work for a profit-making organization?
Yes.
Does your work have anything to do with either the construction or the transportation business?
No.
9 down and 1 to go, Miss Kilgallen.
Does your uniform have a skirt rather than something like pants?
Yes.
I'm so glad. Does it have a relatively high neckline?
Yes.
And sleeves?
Yes.
Could it be more than one color?
No.
That's 10 white. Down and no more to go.
White?
He's a majorette.
Is it a white color?
No, actually, again, you know, on the uniform, it's working garb because,
yeah.
See, Miss Tawney is a restaurant doorman. Oh. He works at the Penguin.
The Penguin.
Penguin restaurant in downtown. It's on
the Must be in the village.
Ninth
West
Street.
Ninth.
Yes,
West
it's the
Ninth
only
Street.
Place they'd have a girl for a doorman.
Such a pretty girl as a doorman, I
what
agree.
What does she wear?
She's also an actress on the side, right?
Yes.
Studying?
Yes.
Actually, it's a student, Martin. That's perfectly right. You go to the neighborhood...
The neighborhood playhouse.
Neighborhood playhouse school, and this is and how she sustains herself while she learns the intricacies. And if you could get...
I had the same Martin. Problem. I got an allowance from home.
Have you ever had to bounce anybody?
Oh, no, that's not my job.
That's not your job.
Now, doormen don't do that.
I'm not that athletic.
Well, Miss Tony, thank you very much for being our guest.
Thank you.
Nice to have you on. We'll meet tonight's mystery guest in just a moment, but first, here is a word from our sponsor. Come to the special feature of our program, the appearance of our mystery challenger. Blindfolds are always on the panel for this particular moment in the program. Are the blindfolds on in place, panel?
Yes,
yes,
John.
Sir. Yes, John.
Will you please enter mystery challenger and sign in? In this case, one question at a time, moving clockwise, and we'll begin with Arlene Francis.
Would one find your name in the entertainment pages of the newspaper?
I would say yes, yes.
Mr. Cerf?
Do you ever, in the course of your professional duties, raise your voice in song?
Once. Very, very little, that's all.
Very, very little. It is not a principal part of the performance. So that's one down and nine to go, Miss Kilgallen.
I don't seem to be on an athletic kick, but are you especially athletic for an actor?
I realize that's
an assumption. Well,
I do a little athletic, but not that much, no.
That's two down at eight to go, Mr. Gabel.
Have you ever been on this panel?
No, I have never been on the panel, no.
Three down at seven to go, Miss Francis.
You sound so dour. Could you be a comedian?
Well, yes, I am.
Mr. Cerf.
Have you done your comic stuff on the Broadway stage within the past year?
Yes, I have, yes.
Miss Kilgallen?
Are you also seen on television?
Yes, I am.
Mr. Gabel?
Are you now in a Broadway musical?
That's true, yes.
Miss Francis?
Broadway musical now. Comedian. Television. Are you in a musical that was based on a comic book?
Yes, I were, yes.
Are you, by any chance, one of the finest entertainers in America, Mr. Sid Caesar?
Yes, yes.
Marvelous.
That was great. That was great, Sid. Little me, can you imagine a big man like Sid in a
well,
program?
Well, he's not the little me, I'll tell you that.
No, sir.
It's just wonderful.
That was a wonderful voice, this guy.
Thank you very much.
And, of course, golly, I guess television will always owe you a tremendous debt. You know, I read somewhere today, reading some collection about the arts in America, and they were talking about television. They talked about the primitive period, 49 and 50,
yes.
You know, Sid, but you brought a great... talent and a great deal of integrity and quality to television. It will always owe you that debt.
He's going to do a new one, aren't you, Sid?
Well, he's now on another network, which
no longer
has
primitive.
The initials ABC, but he does specials. But he was used to every.
Good.
He used to work so hard. I hope you don't work in that hard anymore.
Well, we'll see.
How many changes do you make in Little Mace? It's seven.
There's
how many
23
parts
changes.
Do you play?
23?
23 performances.
Now, he has to be athletic for that.
No, but there, how many different parts do you play? There are seven different parts.
Seven different roles,
seven
yes.
Different.
It's a fine show, a great show.
Thank you very much.
And you do us much honor to give us some time on a Sunday night. Thanks very much.
Thank you, sir.
Wonderful to see you. Well, I think we must agree that you've done rather well so far tonight, panel.
Well, you got nothing but no's, John.
Oh, well, you just got some yeses. We'll have another contestant after this. Now to meet our next challenger. Will you enter and sign in, please? Grace B. Maeda, is that right? Miss or Mrs.?
It's Mrs.
Mrs. Maeda, yes. Where are you from, ma'am?
I'm from Albertson, New York.
Albertson, New York?
Albertson.
Albertson, where is that?
That's on Long Island.
Oh, out on Long Island?
Yes.
Oh, fine. See, I don't know all the towns on Long Island yet. May I present our panel, Mrs. Maeda?
How do you do?
Would you join me over here, please?
Do you know how we keep score?
Yes, I do.
All right, then we'll let the audience at home and the audience in the theater know exactly what your line is. Righty, now, panel, we can tell you that Mrs. Maeda is self-employed and deals in a product. And I think we'll begin the general questioning with Martin Gabel.
Thank you. Mrs. Maeda, do you do your work in Long Island?
Yes, I do.
Is it something to do with a seasonal product?
No.
One down and nine to go, Miss Francis.
Is it a product that I might use?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Is it a product that is found in the home?
No.
That's two down and eight to go, Mr. Cerf.
Is this a manufactured product, Mrs.
Yes,
Maeda?
It is.
Do you handle it after it is manufactured?
Yes, I do.
Is it manufactured by somebody entirely apart from you?
Yes, it is.
Is it solid?
Yes.
Is it used anywhere in the grounds outside the home? You say
yes.
It's not used in the home.
On the ground.
It's used in the grounds.
Right.
Could it be used for purposes of pleasure or relaxation?
No.
I would not say so. I think there's possibly some relationship if the interest were particular and very specific, but I wouldn't say it in any general way, Bennett. That's three down and seven to go, Miss Kilgallen.
Mrs. Maeda, if I bought one of these things and put it in the grounds outside of my home, be pretty funny because I live in the city. Would it remain in the same condition, barring accidents?
Yes, it would.
It's durable, then.
Right.
Would people see it if they came to call?
Yes, they would.
Would it be near the entrance or the pathway to the door?
I would say that it could
relatively,
be.
Relatively, yes.
It could be. This would be pretty much a matter of the discretion of the owner.
Does it rest? Does the bottom part of it rest on the ground?
No, it doesn't.
No. That's four down and six to go, Mr. Gabel.
Is it decorative in any way?
Yes.
This might not be its purpose.
Yes.
But we would agree that it does have a decorative.
But it's also functional.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And is the function to help the grounds or the human beings who inhabit the house as they approach it?
That's very good. Actually, we can answer that with five down and five to go. Ms. Preston.
Now, since it is not based on the ground, does it hang from something?
It could.
Could it,
I'm sorry, Arlene, we've run out of time.
Birdhouse.
Birdhouse is right! Yes! Birdhouses by Maeda, and they have this safety nest feature, which is what Mrs. Maeda is very interested in. They have a baffle built into it so that a big bird can't get its beak up in and attack the nest. That's its special feature, you see.
Good.
And thank you very much for bringing it, your good self, to our program.
I thought a birdhouse.
And now, on that happy note, we can all go birdwatching. Good night, Miss Dorothy Kilgallen.
Good night, John. Good night, Martin.
Night, Dorothy. Arlene.
I have a cuckoo at my house.
Good night, you wizard. Good night, John.
Okay, wizard.
Good night.
Good night, ladies and gentlemen. Thanks for being with us on What's My Line.
What's My Line is a CBS Television Network production in association with Mark Goodson and Bill Cotton. Johnny Olson speaking.
significant week for alumni, I guess. I've been up at Tilton School, my prep school, for an alumni gathering. But I've done some good reporting, too, for the week. And at the risk of embarrassing an old friend of mine, I would announce that this is the year is the 50th anniversary of the Columbia School of Journalism. And on Wednesday of this week, an alumnus of the Graduate School of Journalism, to wit, one Bennett Cerf, was given a Distinguished Alumni Award for Achievement. So there. Now, there are many things about Bennett we very rarely get to say, but he's an old-time newspaperman. Your first job was with the New York Herald Tribune, wasn't it?
Yes, didn't last long. I was fired.
He was fired.
That'll show him.
And that's how he got to be a successful publisher, so I'll see if I can get fired somewhere this week myself. Martin, it's very nice to see you on the panel again, sir.
John, it's always a pleasure to see you.
And I think we'll have some fun tonight. We have some very interesting occupations. More than that, as usual, we'll have our famous mystery guest before my friends on the panel a little bit later in the program, and we'll meet our first challenger. Meet our first contestant. Will you enter and sign in, please? Joe W. Schmitt, right, sir? Schmitt, where are you from?
I'm from O'Fallon, Illinois, and I've just recently moved to Texas.
Texas? Well, you're doing some traveling. It's nice to have you with us. I'm glad you came to New York, too. Thank Mr. Schmitt, may I present the panel? Now, would you join me over here, please? You know how we keep score?
Yes.
All right, then we'll let the audience in the theater and the audience at home know exactly what your line is. All right, panel, we can tell you that Mr. Schmitt is a salaried boy. I fix their suits. I'm a spacesuit man. What a wonderful occupation as a father these days, to be a spacesuit man. Well, needless to say, has to be said, we hope if you see Major Cooper that you will give him our very best and our congratulations, and all those who are in that great company, John Glenn and Walter Sherrod, and certainly Shorty Powers ought to get a good hello, too. He's one of the best men on that microphone we ever heard. Give them all our regards and thanks for coming
sure
to see us,
Mr. Thank you.
Nice to see you. Now to meet our second contestant. Will you enter and sign in, please? Rhea? Well, as an old history student, Tawny, right? Is it Miss or Mrs.?
Yes.
Miss Tawny, and where are you from?
Manhattan.
Manhattan. Mm-hmm. Oh, well, you're right at home this evening. Then, Miss Tawny, may I present our panel? Now, will you join me over here, please? Do you know how we keep score?
Yes.
All right, then we'll let the audience at home and the audience in the theater know exactly what your line is. Panel, we can tell you that Miss Tawny is salaried and deals in a service, and we'll begin the general questioning with that distinguished alumni over there, Mr. Cerf, alumnus, rather, Mr. Cerf. So I got it out for you, did.
Don't be a wizard. Miss Tawny, do you perform your service for members of the human race?
Yes.
For men and women?
Yes.
Do they come to you for this service?
Yes.
Do they, when they come to you for the service, do you come into any kind of physical contact with them?
No.
What's My Line? Brought to you by Geritol. the high-potency vitamin iron-rich tonic in liquid or tablets to help you feel stronger. And now, let's all play What's My Line? And now, live from New York, let's meet our What's My Line panel. First, the popular columnist whose voice of Broadway appears in papers from coast to coast, Miss Dorothy Kilgallen.
And now, a beautiful actor and a wonderful panelist, Mr. Martin Gabel.
On my left, the first and last Mrs. Gabel, Miss Arlene Francis.
I'm glad to hear that. And now, the distinguished president of Random House, whom we all love dearly, Mr. Bennett Cerf.
And here's our linguistic wizard, a man who takes longer to say one sentence than it took Gordon Cooper to go around the world 22 times, John Charles Daly.
All that may be very true, but I can say wizard quicker than he can. Now, this, in a way, is a kind of...
...that he deals in a service, and let's begin the general questioning with Dorothy Kilgallen.
Mr. Schmitt, is your work mental rather than physical?
No.
That's one down and nine to go. Mr. Gabel.
Is your work done outdoors, Mr. Schmitt, more than it is indoors?
No.
That's two down and eight to go, Miss Francis.
Clean score so far.
Do you work with your hands in your job, Mr. Schmitt?
Yes.
Do you work with anything other than human beings in your job?
You speak of other living entities than human beings?
Yes. I know it's a no, John, but yes.
No.
3 down and 7 to go, Bennett.
Mr. Schmitt, do you work for a non-profit making organization?
Yes.
Is it some kind of a government job?
Yes.
Is it a federal government job?
Yes, it is.
Did you have anything whatever to do with the flight of Gordon Cooper concluded the other day?
Yes, sir.
You did. You say you work indoors.
Sir.
Did you have anything to do with the mechanism that tracked his course as he went flying through the heavens?
No.
That's 4 down and 6 to go, but congratulations, Bennett. You've opened a big door, and I'll be quite honest with you. This is going to be difficult for you to get, but it's an extremely interesting assignment. You try, Dorothy.
Mr. Schmitt, you said that your work was physical more than mental.
Yes.
Were you in Florida at the time of the blast-off?
Yes, I was.
Were you at Cape Canaveral?
Yes.
Were you within 100 yards of the gantry?
Yes.
Were you, in fact, at the missile launching site?
Yes.
Right next to it. Did you have anything to do with lifting Gordon Cooper or putting him into the capsule?
Yes.
Did you put him into the capsule?
He had an assignment, Dorothy, that had a relationship to the whole concatenation of events which saw Cooper go into the capsule and then subsequently remain there.
He was the master of ceremonies.
No, but very good. Martin?
Mr. Schmitt, as my wife will tell you, I can't do anything with my hands. So I don't think I could be very helpful here, and I pass.
All right, Arlene?
Well, now, the fact is that you were present when he entered the capsule. Is that, we are on that?
Yes.
We're that far. Did you hold something in your hands at this particular time?
No.
Not exactly. I'm going to put all the cards over because this is really great. Mr. Schmitt is a space suit technician and was actually the last man in the capsule with Major Cooper. He makes the connections from between the space suit and the capsule. He helped to dress him, or did dress him, goes out with him, checks him in the capsule.
Why did he get so hot? That spacesuit.
They closed that door too soon. You'd have been in there with them, wouldn't you?
I was watching that.
John?
Yes, Dorothy?
I think Mr. Schmidt's title should be Space Valet.
Space Valet?
Or Scientific Valet.
Think very it, good. It would be a good one. I dare say they've thought of that down in Cape Canaveral because they have a patois all of their own down there, and that probably comes into it, too. But I think Arlene's question was very interesting. Can you tell us, you know, why the variations in temperature is this?
Well, this has happened on most all of our flights so far. Actually, this is not in my area. This pertains to the environmental control system and the adjustment that they make to properly cool the suit is a slow is one. It's one that requires a little time after you make a slight adjustment.
It because
takes
it
a while
cool.
for it to stabilize.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
He said that he was cool after a while.
Yeah, this is so.
Yes.
Once you get it adjusted, you don't have any further problems.
May I ask you a personal question? Are you any youngsters yourself?
Yes, they're not really so young. I have one daughter who is married. And I have a son going to high school.
Okay. I was just thinking, what a wonderful position to be in as a father. And say, well, Daddy, what do you do? Well, I dress all the astronauts. Several, you know, when they go upstairs.